is a lecturer in public policy and management here at the Kennedy School. His work focuses on the public sector and on making it more efficient and more equitable and is responsible and more responsible for social needs. He is the faculty director here at the Kennedy School, a very interesting project, which I think you'll hear a bit about, which is called the Bloomberg Harvard City Leadership Initiative. He's also worked with a number of mayors from around the United States and a number of other exciting projects. A number of you are Chinese or are been involved with China as I have, and he also has worked extensively in China, training programs for Chinese leaders and business people as well. Our second guest is Professor Sun Yangang, who is a very distinguished Chinese artist, graphic artist, known the world over. He is a professor of art at Beida, Peking University, and also is the founder of the Zhaochangdi, the art colony outside of Beijing. But he's here in a very different capacity, which is that his recent work has focused on artificial intelligence, and he is doing some very original thinking about how the future is going to look, how the human future is going to look in the wake of artificial intelligence, and also thinking about how to create new combinations, new synergies between research and business and the public. So you will be hearing from him as well. And I should say each of us are rather different from each other, and you'll get three divergent, somewhat divergent viewpoints. I'm going to begin. I'll be the first speaker. Professor De Jong will go next, and then Professor Sun. I have to begin with a warning and maybe even an apology, which is to say that this is a very difficult, argued topic, AI, artificial intelligence. There are as many opinions as there are experts and commentators. There, on many points, is a general agreement about AI, about its future, about its advantages and its dangers. So it's a very complex topic. I would begin by saying that public perceptions of the general public, and I know there are people in this audience who have a great deal of expertise, in fact, or at least are studying this professionally or as part of their education, but I would say that public perceptions have, to a certain extent, been driven by science fiction, by films, by novels, by a lot of fantastic, futuristic thinking. Going back to the 19th century, Frankenstein, Jack London wrote a novel about the future run by machines. The word robot was invented by a Czech playwright in 1921, Karel Slapek, who wrote a play called R.U.R., Rossum's Universal Robots. He invented the word robot, which we now all use. Aldous Huxley's Brave New World, George Orwell's 1984, Stanislaw Lem, movies like Terminator and Blade Runner, all of these have fed the public imagination about a future world in which machines, in some sense, replace or even take over control of human life. So there's lots of fantasy and very few facts. But facts are what we're after, and perceptions that are grounded in the evolution of an exciting new technology is really what we're here to talk about today. I'm going to refer to a number of the best experts, what I think are the best experts that I've been reading and listening to. One of them, familiar to a lot of you, is Kai-Fu Lee, who used to be head of Google in China, now runs a venture capital firm that invests exclusively in AI. And Kai-Fu Lee says, AI is very simple, understand it or die. And he means that in professional commercial terms, but also perhaps in a larger sense. AI is really something that is here to stay and will grow, and that we need to begin to come to terms with and begin to acknowledge and to analyze and to discuss. So as I said, a global dialogue is what we need. We need to assess the pros and the cons, the disadvantages of AI, as individuals, as communities, as societies, and as governments. One more difficulty, and all the AI scientists will tell you this is, as one put it very simply but elegantly, he said, we don't know what we don't know. The field is evolving so fast that it's hard to even figure out what the next step is and what's going to come up and what is known and what is unknown. So there are going to be these quantum leaps sometimes in a short period of time. Another very good person, if you want to read about AI, is Andrew Moore. Andrew Moore is the head of the artificial intelligence effort at Carnegie Mellon University. And Andrew Moore says, if you think of the aeronautics industry, the airline industry, AI is today where that industry would have been in about 1935. So it's just evolving. It's got a long way to evolve, and it's going to happen very fast. So what I'm going to try and do today as the kind of big picture guy is to give you a sense of some of the current uses, some of the future uses, some of the very important moral and ethical and practical issues that AI arises. Then Professor de Jong is going to, who's much more the practitioner than I am, is going to talk about some very specific uses already on the ground, as it were, in the area of smart cities that he's been involved with. And then Professor Sun is going to help us look at the future and think about the future in a broader sense. So we'll kind of go from the general to the specific and back to the general again. Very few brief definitions. AI experts tend to, and I want to stop and say one thing about the term artificial intelligence. It's artificial. There's artificial intelligence and there's human intelligence. And as I go through this, I want to sometimes stop and separate those two. Increasingly, artificial intelligence is becoming very, very skilled at replacing, first mimicking and then replacing human intelligence. But as I think you would all probably recognize, and as I'm going to suggest, the two, it's not necessarily feasible that one will replace the other, so that human intelligence will become obsolete. It will change, and the uses of human intelligence will change. But artificial means artificial, not natural. But AI experts will tell you that there are kind of two stages of the development of AI. And the first one, which we're very much in the midst of already, is what they call cognitive assistance, where computers already in a number of areas, and I'm going to talk about them, can greatly outperform humans basically at analyzing data. Huge pieces of data. The bigger the data, the better, the bigger the gap between human capacity and machine capacity. Just some examples of cognitive assistance technologies, the ability to memorize, particularly facial recognition technologies. There are now technologies that can recognize in a matter of seconds 3 million different human faces. Now, obviously, no human brain can do that. So this is one of the areas. Classification of cutting across many areas, big data. Perception, recognizing patterns. Again, the more data, the better. Prediction for things that are part of our everyday lives, like weather, and traffic, but also many, many other uses. And the second stage of the development of AI, which is also developing in a very clear way, is autonomy. The point at which, and it's that second stage that a lot of the science fiction and fantasy that I was talking about is focused, where machines have a certain autonomy, where you give a computer a goal and some rules and then let it find its own way. So that's the second stage of AI. AI I'm also going to use today in a very broad, and as I'm sure a few of you may scold me for this, not entirely scientific sense. I'm going to say that I'm going to use AI as a cover word for a range of different types of technology, all of which are developing very quickly. The most promising and the one that's come fastest is what's called machine learning, machine's ability to take in data and learn. It's already being applied in things like real estate law, state of California, where machines can analyze and search real estate regulations and help to create solutions much faster than humans, which has implications for lawyers, by the way, but we'll get to lawyers later. We have, of course, robots who are able to do an increasing number of functions in manufacturing, but also in domestic life. We have drones, we have mobile sensors, we have 3D printing, we have something that we're all familiar with and we'll come back to, which is autonomous vehicles, self-driving vehicles, and we have virtual reality. VR, as it's called, has great promise in terms of its ability to train people to deal with dangerous situations. That is, if you are training people for natural disaster, finding victims after an earthquake or a flood, you have to simulate things. You can't actually practice under dangerous conditions, but VR enables people to become familiar with the feeling and the texture of that experience. Similarly, it of course has its uses in military and defense, where you're not going to have an actual battle, but you can simulate battle conditions and train people to respond to them. AI so far has been concentrated in a distinct set of sectors. And this list is not comprehensive, it's a little obvious, but I'm going to mention them and I'm going to come back to them. Again, very advanced uses we're seeing, and everyone in this room is part of it and everyone knows what I'm talking about, is of course for consumer products and online sales. Ken Olson, the president of Digital Equipment Company in 1977, said, there's no reason why anyone would want to have a computer in their home. So here are four experts in their own field that underestimated technology. And my fifth and final quote, and I will end here, and I'm sorry for going on longer than I meant to, is an example of overestimating the effects of technology. In 1963, Life magazine, now Life magazine isn't around anymore, but if you were growing up in the 60s, Life magazine was dominant. The cover of Life magazine was where you looked first. It was where things were happening. And in 1963, over 50 years ago, was a cover that said, and I quote, automation is really here, jobs are disappearing, we are at the point of no return for everybody. Well, we're not yet at the point of no return 50 years later. Automation is real, but human capacity to innovate and to deal with change is infinite. I thank you very much for your attention.
Welcome everybody to the Kennedy School. It's a great pleasure to be here with you today and to talk about a topic that's near and dear to my heart, which is the smart city. And it's at the intersection of artificial intelligence and public policy and public management. As you know, the Harvard Kennedy School focuses on how we can make the world a better place through government action, through cross-sectoral collaboration with the private sector, through citizen engagement, mobilizing all of our resources and all of our creativity and intelligence to address social problems, to improve the quality of life, and to make this this planet a little bit safer and more sustainable. So this is a topic that's obviously extremely relevant, and I don't think that we could have had a better introduction to the topic than Robin's address. I thought it was very comprehensive, very insightful, covered a lot of ground. So don't worry about taking too much time. She set us up for a great conversation. So what I'll do today is talk a little bit about this concept of a smart city. And smart implies intelligence, right? But whose intelligence? Is it the intelligence of people, the intelligence of organizations, the intelligence of a community, or the intelligence of all the technology and science that we have around us and that are increasingly in us and work through us? So this whole confluence of artificial intelligence and human intelligence is important to unpack. So what I'll do is talk a little bit about how I come at this topic and the way I'm engaged with this with my students and my colleagues here. talk about the Bloomberg Harvard City Leadership Initiative, which focuses a lot on making cities smarter, but also making mayors smarter. If you have a smart city, you need to have a smart mayor, and vice versa. I'll talk a little bit about, you know, what are the particular implications of the rise of artificial intelligence for public policy and management in cities. And then I'll talk about some policy areas where we see some challenges as well as opportunities. So this is going to be kind of a key thread through my talk, which is that artificial intelligence and the new technological opportunities provide us with obvious benefits, immediate benefits, sometimes long-term benefits. Sometimes we have technology, we don't know what to do with it yet, but you can see kind of the future emerge from that. But there's also big challenges, you know, things that technology can do, but we're a little on the fence if we should do it, right? And so I particularly worry about thoughtless adoption of technology. And so embracing technological opportunities without really thinking about the implications and the implications for individual human beings, or the implications for us as a community, the implications for particular vulnerable groups in our communities. And so I think to be a smart city is to be smart, not just in seeing the opportunities, but also to be smart in dealing with the challenges and thinking politically and philosophically about what we should do, what we could do, what we need to do, and what we might do. And then I'll end with a couple of dilemmas, I think, political and ideological and philosophical dilemmas that artificial intelligence presents us with, especially when we think about cities. And as Robin said, in 2050, you know, 70% of the population of this planet will live in cities. So just do a straw poll. Who lives in a city? Right. Who lives in a smart city? See? We're not there yet, Robin. Very few people would say that they live in a smart city, because most of the time we're kind of annoyed with the traffic. I mean, we may, you know, be aware of the, you know, the concept of autonomous vehicles, but not here yet. And, you know, we're stuck in traffic, or we deal with inefficient government bureaucracies. We have to fill out paperwork, right? Paper. And yes, that's still how we do a lot of business with the government. And we don't feel that we have a real-time connection with our government. It's just, everything feels slow, and you know, it takes forever to repair stuff. It takes forever to do urban planning, right? And very often we feel that we're surrounded by obsolete government organizations and structures. And so this whole notion of the government bureaucracy is something that we'll have to deal with, because as smart as the technologies can make us, if we are still operating in outdated and obsolete organizational structures, how the hell are we going to capitalize on all that? So at some point, technology and new structures, especially implemented by the private sector, can overtake governance structures. For example, take Uber or Airbnb, new companies, or Amazon for that matter, new companies that have a different business model and use technologies to provide services. And the adoption rate is astronomous. I mean, everybody uses it and these companies take off. But then, of course, these companies depend on the regulatory frameworks of our cities, right? So if your city, London, just you know, basically fined Uber because they were not in compliance with some of the regulations. And so if they don't comply, I think before the end of the month, they're out of business in London. And 40,000 cab drivers who work for Uber in London will have to find another form of employment. Now, I don't think that will happen. I think everybody will be smart enough to make sure that they're in compliance. But it just is one example of how those new technologies and new business models enabled by those technologies come into conflict with organizational structures and policy frameworks and regulation that has not been adopted and adapted to these new realities. So to be a smart city is to be smart about what is happening, what is the opportunity, what's the threat, and how do we deal with the challenges. Here is that a smart city is a city that realizes the full potential of its citizens and organizations by optimizing real human intelligence and capabilities, so that it may see, understand, and deal with the opportunities and challenges presented by AI in an effective and responsible way. And if that happens, then it will be beneficial to all of us, we might actually think of a very bright future. I do think that we're not there yet, and you know, we here at Harvard, with the Bloomberg Harvard City Leadership Initiative, are committed to kind of investing in that human intelligence and those organizational capabilities, so that we might actually take advantage in the best possible way of AI. I'd like to leave it there, and thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Professor Dale. Professor Sundianga.
He said, now it's time to start the Chinese show. Everybody's So these two professors have been talking about the effects of artificial intelligence on society.
这个社会呢出了很多的问题，但并不是专家所说的这一点问题，他只是说了问题的这个社会的一点。
So there are a large scope of problems that affect our society, and our two professors who just spoke, they touched on a few of them, but there are much more that we haven't talked about yet.
所以呢，我这个烧脑了又来了啊，就是我要不是在点上，我要从整体上跟你们梳理一下人工智能对这个世界的影响是什么。So
right now we're going to get a broader scope and understanding of the actual effects that artificial intelligence is going to have on society as a whole.
初级的人工智能呢，的确是个技术层面的事。So
the basic understanding of what artificial intelligence is technology.
但是呢，从哲学的角度，从人类学的角度，它不只是技术那个一点点的人工智能那个意义。So
from the understanding of the philosophy and of human thought, the artificial intelligence isn't just a piece of technology. It's more.
我今天在讲的就是整个现代化文明这个文明整体。今天多少号？23号啊，over了。So
the culture of society as we know it,
over.
It's gone. Today.
为什么我这么讲呢？现代文明从人文主义、民主、自由、法治这套体系、这套谎言讲到今天，讲不下去了。So
the classical narrative of feudalism to democracy and then to communism or totalitarianism, this classic historical narrative of power structures cannot continue.
因为它是用谎言跟暴力想象的一个国家体来控制每一个人的思想、自由、行为。Because
what happened in the past is these governmental structures have been using beautiful words and classical understandings of what the world is to control society.
这套民主制度是工业化的产物。 它不是未来人类自己的需求，我需要一个什么样的国家，需要一个什么样的服务体，那不是我们想要的，是用暴力谎言跟共同的一种黑社会组织把我们给控制住了。So
right now the way that the world is structured is kind of like the mafia. We're being run by gangsters who are controlling the world with their own systems. But the thing is that right now we have the opportunity to figure out what it is, how we can really govern ourselves.
国家是什么?
What is a country?
我给你交税, 你来给我管事儿, 必须是平等的, 我不想给你交税, 你又不应该给我管事儿, 并不是, 你必须得给我交税, 我必须给你管事儿。 太可怕,这是一个不是公平的原则。
So right now what's happening is we're paying taxes and we're expecting benefit, but the social benefit is it's invisible. It doesn't happen. So what kind of relationship is that we have with our government? It's not a good one.
Okay. 上帝统治我们的时候, 就是信仰你是必须的, 你不信上帝就会被烧死。 Oh my God, 我不信上帝就被烧死。
So originally, when theology first came around and people believed in the Christian faith or religion, the idea was that if you broke God's rules, he would kill you right away.
Google 有上千亿对人类的贡献比国家大得多, 政府一个法令明天让你关门你就关门了。
Google has the GDP of many countries combined, trillions of dollars in power, but the government can close it down with one letter.
这样的暴力组织还能延续吗? 国家政府这种暴力组织还能延续吗?
So can we continue using these classical laws and traditions that the government has set out for us?
现代文明这种国家体系, 你认为法律能保护你吗?
So do you have faith that the legal system of today can protect you?
你认为国家是公平正义的代表吗?
Does the government actually represent a fair and honest way of governance?
人类在自我懦弱的时候, 没有能力的时候, 他相信上帝能保护我, 能爱护我, 能保佑我。
In the beginning of civilization, when people had no way of interacting with their environment effectively as we do today, the only thing that there was to believe that God would help us.
这个故事讲不下去之后, 又有一些人骗子出来了, 认为自由民主法律法治能保佑我们, 从人文主义这套东西出来, 又把我们人类统治了好几百年。
So once I think what he's talking about is when Nietzsche said, God is dead, right? From that point on, there was the Industrial Revolution, and with industry came laws and democracy and governance through these industrial channels. But that was that story as of today cannot continue.
工业化之后的现代国家制度，从有国家开始，现代化说。 就是有战争、屠杀、野蛮，而且是公开的、合法的。So once industry
came along and imperialism became the word of the day, what countries did is they would travel around and occupy places and kill the native people and take the resources. That was how governments worked.
因为我们每个民族、每个个人、每个人都不够强大。 所以要委托一个暴力集团给我们解决事儿。
So people, ourselves, we cannot exist as a single individual in this world. We have to do something to some sort of organization that is going to protect us. We have to have some sort of relationship with a protective organization.
所以现代文明这种体系，啊，讲不下去了。
So the narrative of today's form of governance cannot continue beyond the Reformation of AI.
那未来我们怎么办?
What are we going to do?
哎呀，人工智能的出现，让科技进步，让我们每个人都非常强大了起来。
With the advent of artificial intelligence, it'll give each person strength and the opportunity to live as one.
虽然人工智能是一个小小的科技进步，实际上它是人类基因突变、主动基因突变改造人类的一个 可能性吧。
So even though this advent of artificial intelligence may seem small and insignificant, in reality, this scientific advancement has the possibility of altering the genetic makeup of humans.
这个可能性呢，从人类历史学的角度啊，它可能你感觉是微微的一点，但是它的影响力是改变整个人类思维模式、认知的一种新的革命。
So what's going to happen is even if this possibility happens where artificial intelligence does change the genetic makeup of humans, even though the change in our genetic makeup might be microscopic, it will have huge effects in how we think, act, feel, relate, and live.
不知道从这个角度呢，你们有没有烧脑的感觉？
I don't know if you guys are dizzy from this.
We're worried.
所以呢，我不是两个专家，我也不是两个教授。 他们讲得很专业，很有高度。He
says, I'm not a professional, and I'm not a professor. I don't have the academic posture of these two wonderful professors.
他们的理论可以改变他们的学问，改变他们的问题，改变这个问题。So
their understanding and professionalism can help solve these problems.
我要改变人类。I
want to change humanity.
我们人类不能这么活着了。There's
no way for us to continue living the way we are.
Okay. 所以呢，我不是个学者范儿，我是个流氓范儿。哈哈哈哈哈哈！直接流，他不知道怎么翻。流氓是吗？
川普套，川普，川普范儿。I'm an individual, not to be ruled by gangsters.
所以呢，我觉得今天我们聚在这一起啊，我们不是在讲大道理，我们没时间讲道理，那些道理也没有意义。我们要启发性的东西。苏老师，我有什么问题？就我们要问题的对接，现在是问题。So.
So right now we don't have time to talk about the structure of the ethical systems, or we don't have time to talk about the lessons of philosophy and government that have been already taught in the past. There's no time for that. Right now what we have to do is ask questions and stimulate the questioning in our brains to figure out new ways and new solutions. Professor Sim likes questions a lot.
现代文明这些事儿，现代的国家体制，现代这些事儿，并不是技术改造就可以解决它的问题。技术改造、技术升级根本不能改造社会这个社会问题，是它必须要over的。So
there is no way for us to have technology, in immediately change our society. The only way for us to do this is to end the society as we know it, and allow for the revolution to begin.
创造性的东西，创造的这个主题，成为人类改造未来的一个新的创造创新这个东西，创造这个东西，是解决现代问题的最根本的问题。So
the biggest problem that we have right now is that we are not in a state of mind for innovation. Once we accept that innovation and disruption are the only ways that we can advance and tackle this problem, then we can start solving it.
毁灭性的创造，毁灭和创造，它是共生的。我们东方人讲涅槃，啊，这个很好。涅槃是什么？我一定要跳入火中，我才涅槃，我才能重生。不可能，我去更新，我不断的更新，不可能。
Yeah. So the disruption and innovation of all the technology and industry that we know is going to force a rebirth of humanity.
我们讲，我们待会儿我大概
So I'm almost done talking. We're going to start with our questions.
完了，向我开炮啊！我就怕你们不吭气。
He's afraid you guys don't have enough energy. We got to get the energy up a little bit. Start asking questions and innovate. Solve this problem.
Okay. Can you do it?
So what a lot of people do in humanities is they look at the problem and then they look at the angle of the problem and then try to solve it from the problem's perspective. But that's not how we can solve this kind of issue.
不管是问题还是解决问题，其实它都有它的时效性。
So it doesn't matter if it's a problem or a solution to a problem, everything has its own level of effectiveness and
usefulness.就是在你死之前，这个病都没有瞧好，但是你死了，这病也就没有。
So if you have a very, very bad illness, right? And then, you know, all of a sudden, you know, you don't know what the illness is, but the illness kills you, the illness is gone as well. And there's no way to know what it was.
就不管你身上有十个病，都不是治病的病，只要有一个治病的病，你那十个病就不需要治了，你已经死了。
So even if you have, imagine your body has 10 different types of serious disease, and only one of them is treatable. And you treat that one disease, but the other nine are still going to kill you anyway.
所以社会上的很多的问题，我们没有时间去一个一个解决。我们现在就是要解决现代社会这个体制是不是over了，是不是结束了，是不是要重新开始了。So
right now the question isn't, you know, which sections of society can we change? What parts of our lives do we have to alter in the wake of the artificial intelligence revolution? It's more so, in the face of this technology, do we have to start over? Do we have to make society new again?
随着人类从历史走到现在，从现在走到未来，很多的问题都不需要解决，因为时间就告诉你这个事儿过去了。
So from the beginning of humanity until recent humanity and from the present day until the future, there's lots of problems that came and went, but there was no need to solve them.
我们现在的整体的人，整体的这个文明体系，它是崩盘式的衰落，你根本不是靠一个螺丝，靠改革一个制度，一个方法，就能让这个世界整体的，不去衰亡，不可能。
So right now there's no way to use any of our current understanding to approach the existing social strata system in a way that can effectively reform it.
所以我们要解决人类的这个跟未来的这种发展现代的结束，你才有可能人类整体的跨越现代文明进后现代进入人类进入另一个时代，这个是一个。 跨越式的，不是一个升级版，它更多的是一个，回去要一定要学东方的什么叫涅槃重生。就是 OK, so
right now what's happening is there's so many people that we have to figure out how to handle it. It's not a question of how society will reform, but if this social reformation can happen.
所以我们不要恐惧未来。人工智能的到来，的确它会有一种新的思维模式、新的生命学对整体人类的一种跨越。但是你恐惧未来，没有意义。So
if you try to, there's no point in trying to control the outcomes of the future, because the effect that artificial intelligence is going to have on humans as a whole and on humanity is so immense that the problems of today will not be the problems of tomorrow.
未来会出现什么问题，它不是现在的问题，它是未来的问题。未来有它的问题，就有它的解决问题。
So the problems of tomorrow will be solved tomorrow.
Okay.
So no reason to solve them today.
我想说，就是网上有说，就是有这样一种观点说，就是人类从石器时代进化到现在，就是 what is the purpose？ 为了什么
？OK。
English version of the question. So there is a saying that I read that us humans that from Stone Age to now is kind of like a high profile civilization. So what is the purpose of our evolution? And there's one idea said that actually we humans is kind of like a vehicle or tool for intelligence. Now, that tool has used us to go so far, and until we come into the age of artificial intelligence, the intelligence is now kind of like abandon us from carbon-based life, go to silicon-based life. So, do you have any comments on this kind of idea? Thank you.
Okay. 我想跟你说啊，就一切的学说都是歪理学说。被科学验证的不等于不是歪理学说，啊，一切的学说呀都是歪理学说，被科学验证过的也不一定不是歪理学说，听明白吗？我先从意义上说解决你的问题，就说你这个问题，说有人这么说，有人那么说，不管他怎么说都没有问题，都没有问题，不是他的问题有问题，是你要通过这些问题找到你想要的意义。
So he's saying that in response to such thoughts, you have to realize that, you know, these thoughts are based off of conclusions from scientific systems that are in use today based on our current understanding of the world and the environment that we live in. And that, you know, thoughts like these, or, you know, predictions such as the one that you've just very eloquently outlined, are not necessarily going to be the reality of tomorrow. Because the predictions in science that they're based on could be broken at any minute. And there's no reason to think that, you know, when you approach these questions, you have to use it, the question, to find purpose for yourself.
就人类啊，人类从现代化进入智能化，这个是历史的必然。这是历史的必然。
So the evolution of humanity from our current state that's been the same since the Stone Age for 80,000 years, our current evolution into an artificial intelligence age is a necessary product of history.
其实生命就是意义的载体。如果你的生命没有意义，你活着也没什么意义。活着有意义，就生命就是我意义的载体。如果我没有意义，就没有价值。价值跟意义，就我有了意义，我才有活着生命的这个载体。是意义最重要。
So purpose is the most important. If your life has no purpose, then you'll be lost, and there's nothing that you can do until you find that purpose.